I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Charles Larson's inside story of television murder. Someone's death. Starring George Kennedy. Joyce Bulifant. And Robert Reed. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Ford Motor Company and Metropolitan Life Insurance Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
The medium of television has become very much a part of our lives. Good, bad, or indifferent, television exists. When it's bad, one has only to turn it off. Unfortunately, the same cannot be said for murder. Once committed, the act lingers on, as do the consequences. Nils Frederik Blixen produces television programs. Joanna Redfern is his casting director. Dan Gladstone was her boyfriend. An ex-boyfriend who met extinction when shot through the head by an unknown assailant. The police are casting young Joanna as the murderer. Nils Frederik prefers to disagree, and he's screening a large cast of character types to fill the role. Nils Frederik Blixen. He thought he knew it all. Someone's death will continue after this message.
I overslept. Got in my office about 10:30. It was all in the paper. The murder, Joanna working on the series. At least they got my name wrong. They called me R.G. Blixman. The phone had been ringing all morning. My boss, Arthur Todd, among others. My secretary is a real brain. The trade papers, the scandal sheets, she told them all the same thing. I was out. So as not to make her a liar, I left the executive building, passed along a row of darkened projection rooms, climbed some narrow wooden stairs to a frosted glass door marked Research. There I found old man Tibbet. He'd been in charge of this department since it opened. When he referred to the big war, he meant number one.
Ah, hey. Yeah, Mr. Nils Frederik Blixen in person. How's the new series coming?
Walter, I've got a tough job for you.
Yeah?
I want to know what magazine these words were cut out of. Can you do it?
In other words, you're thinking of using this threat letter in a script? Oh, they won't let you use language like this on TV.
No, just something I'm working on. What I want you to do is find what magazines these words were cut out of. Could you do it if I gave you a general area, like comic books?
Well, I could try. Who do I charge my time to if it's not a TV episode?
To me. On the way back to my office, I stopped in at the executive washroom, which bears a slight resemblance to the Taj Mahal, and ran into my star, Murph Smith, combing his hair in front of one of the mirrors, a broken-nosed, slope-shouldered man in his late 30s.
This murder, Nils Frederik. I called Mr. Todd at 3 this morning and asked him to get rid of the Redfern girl. He promised he would. I always thought she was a little gummed up.
Did you?
Well, you know, hanging around with all those blacks. Hey, by the way, why do I have to be Jewish in this series?
I didn't know things like that bothered you, Murph. You want things separate but equal, right?
Right.
Did Acadia Playhouse work that way, too, when you were there? I met a friend of yours last night, Bobby something. He lives with Rene Orthez.
Oh, Bobby. Yes, he went to Acadia.
So did Dan Gladstone, and he was murdered.
I've got it. We never mention I'm Jewish. I play it Jewish inside. And my secretary, Raquel, we play her blonde. A lot of Mexicans are, you know. You buy that?
No. Is that clear enough? No.
Oh, come on. I haven't demanded much.
You haven't deserved much. You'll play it the way it's written. Is that clear? The way it's written. Well,
Come on. It's a gag. You're the producer. What the heck do I know? Okay?
When I got to the studio in the morning, the Chavez test was underway. I didn't have to see it. The reports came to my office from those in the know. Cameramen, grips, all the guys on the set who'd seen him come and go. She was sensational, was all they said. Finally, I decided to go down and take a look for myself. When I reached the door of the stage, there was Preston Andrade. We were both stopped from entering by a blinking red light.
Hey, pal, how are you?
You started working here now?
No. Remember you invited us? And what do you know? A friend of mine is in there testing for your series.
You know Isabel Chavez?
Do I know her? Boom Boom's inside. We all know each other.
Then you and Isabel are friends?
Oh, for years. Since my wife died in 1960.
Isn't Boom Boom jealous?
Jealous? She hates her, even though I'm old enough to be Isabel's grandfather. It's like with you and Red. It's just Boom Boom likes to come to her set. Want some coffee from the machine? I could use some.
No, thanks. Incidentally, have the police been around questioning you and Boom Boom and the others?
I'm not worried. I got an alibi. I was in Tijuana on business. I heard there was some good cashmere down there.
I suppose everybody else was home.
Well, Bobby and Renee were home. Boom Boom was at a preview. Phil, I'm not sure.
About Boom Boom's husband?
Fred? No, I think he had a lodge meeting. You know, that kid Phil works too hard. All day at the drugstore, then practices, eats, and falls into bed.
Where does he sleep?
In my room, back of the flat.
Then you'd know if he ever tried to sneak out.
I don't think he does, which is more than I can say for our little neighbor.
Which little neighbor?
Heidi. She sneaks out nights.
Do you know that for sure?
As sure as I've seen her crawl out her bathroom window.
You've seen her?
Many times. She has to pass my room.
Where does she go?
Who knows? But I know what she'd say if I asked her where she was going.
What's that?
Out.
I spent just long enough on stage 16 to verify that Red's actress find, Isabel Chavez, was indeed the new Cara Jurado. On the way to the office, I ran the usual gamut of disaster. My production manager beefing about the number of setups, my associate producer bringing me network static about credits, and then the front office informed me I'd lost my first choice director and would have to beat the bushes at this late date for a replacement. If that wasn't enough, I found my secretary in tears.
Oh, Mr. Blixen, I hate to bring my personal problems to the office. It's nothing. I mean, it's something, but it just can't be helped. Let's not talk about it.
Let's.
Well, it's my father. My mother called this morning from Chicago, and he's 72, and they just found out he's got cancer.
I'm sorry, ma'am. Would you like to go there?
I just can't waltz off and leave you. Not in the beginning of the season. Maybe later. We'll see. They're going to keep me notified, and if I have to go, I'll go later. Oh, so now I've added another little straw to your back. Let's see. Mr. Schreiber called. He said it was important. Shall I get him back?
Yes, please. I'll take it inside. Yes, Wade.
Mills? Look, I've had another conversation with my friend at the North Hollywood station. Apparently, Joanna lied to them about something. All he'd say was she told a whopper they've checked up on it, and she's in big trouble. Now, he expects Sergeant Ames to go to the DA within the next 10 days.
If it's about the car, she told you she borrowed Renee's car that night, didn't
she? Yeah, she told me that, and I told the police it's not that. They've checked Renee's tires, and they don't match the tracks they found.
I didn't know that they'd found any tracks.
Oh, yeah, a couple of pretty good ones. Fairly well-worn firestones.
Then what else could it be?
Well, unfortunately, she's the only suspect who seems to have had both motive and no real alibi to speak of.
What about Gladstone's clientele? Surely Ames knows by now he was a pusher.
No, Gladstone was very small potatoes, just starting out. His supplier's in Tijuana, but informers haven't turned up a thing.
Wade, you still have a couple of private operatives on the payroll?
Yeah. Listen, if you got an angle, tell me.
Preston Andrade. He said he was in Tijuana the night of the murder buying cashmere. Now, there's nothing easier to check out.
So, what's your point?
I don't know. I'm fishing. But people have a tendency to project their own attitudes. Maybe Andrade's the jealous, possessive one.
You saying that Boom Boom and Dan Gladstone were playing around?
Why not?
Well, Nils, she's old enough to
What's age got to do with it? To hear you people talk, you'd think that everybody went off into a cocoon or something at the age of...
Nils, look, I'm sorry, all right? I'll write it down. Preston Andrade, Tijuana, jealous, okay? Anything else?
Oh, Andrade's wife died in 1960. I want to know how.
Wife, how?
And as long as we're reconfirming alibis, find out if Renee and Bobby were really both home on the night of the murder. Motive, jealousy again.
Renee, Bobby, both home. Okay, go on.
Phil?
The kid isn't a suspect.
He uses downers. More than occasionally. Question who supplied him. Suppose he wanted out, and his source wouldn't leave him alone. And I'd also like to know why he left Hollywood High.
Phil, Holly High. Okay.
I don't know if Heidi can drive a car.
Nils, is there anybody you don't suspect?
Certainly. Red. Monday morning, a series went before the cameras with more problems than I care to recount. And my neck stuck out to hear for having signed Isabel Chavez. Not to mention my star, Murph Smith's charming acceptance of his leading lady.
I am not going to work with that fat-headed Joel. No way ever. I want that human fright way out of my series. I'm the star. I'm getting out.
He was an overpaid employee of NFB Productions, and he'd honor his commitment or answer in court, and that's what I told him. We were only a half a day behind schedule at the end of the first day's shooting, and I was badly in need of a drink. Mary was not in the office. She was probably down in the ladies' room. She'd been doing a lot of crying lately. So I had to look for the whiskey myself. I found it where she'd filed it, under W. And I was walking into my office in search of a glass. Wade Schreiber was stretched out on my couch, his arm over his face. I made that two glasses. Might as well give me the bad news. I can read it all over you.
Well, if there's one rule a lawyer's trained to live by, it's never get personally involved with a client.
Red's in trouble.
Nothing a miracle wouldn't cure.
Well, if you're going to tell me, tell me.
All right, Nils. Brace yourself. You know the .22 that was used to kill Gladstone?
They found it?
Not yet. But they found out where it was purchased. And a gun dealer says he sold it to a young woman.
Let me guess. The woman was a redhead.
There'll probably be a warrant out for Red by tonight.
Warrant for murder?
You betcha. Murder one.
Wade Schreiber straight-lined the information. A clerk in a pawn shop in Fraser, a little town in the Imperial Valley, remembered his boss selling a .22 to a young lady from Los Angeles on the 5th or the 6th of May. That was the weekend Joanna and Gladstone had had their big fight. The 6th was also the Sunday, Joanna had told the police, when she just got into her car and drove through the Imperial Valley.
Yeah, if the guy can identify Joanna's picture, they'll have her.
They won't have anything except a girl who bought a gun in a moment of fear and panic. Probably to defend herself with.
Yeah, that's what I like about you, Nils, an unbiased opinion.
Have you told Joanna?
I would if I could find her, but I can't. I think she's run out.
Well, the police know where she is. She's their chief suspect. They must have a tail on her.
Your TV detective would have a tail on. A real policeman can't afford those luxuries.
Well, she's got to be around. Maybe she went to the beach.
What, in this weather? Come on, Nils.
Doesn't Boom Boom know where she is?
No, and no sign of Boom Boom either. No sign of anybody. Except Ellis' granddaughter.
Heidi? Andrade tells me that Heidi's been sneaking out of the house at night. Heidi hates Red with a blind passion. Red reminds her of her mother.
Suggesting what? That she's trying to get even for the dirty trick her mother pulled on her? Nils, this is a child we're talking about.
Children hate and sometimes kill. Where would you expect to see the word paramour in print?
Well, I don't know. Victorian novel?
And this word was cut out from a magazine. Cheap ink. Semi-pulp stock, some letters in color, some hand-lettered. Who are today's Victorians, today's adolescents? And what do adolescents read? Comic books.
There were comic books piled to the ceiling in that garage, but anybody in the fourplex could have gotten to them. And you can't be absolutely positive the words were cut out of those comic books.
Well, I'm working on it. As I entered the soundstage, they had just wrapped up the day's shooting. My star had retreated and peeked to his dressing room. Isabel Chavez was slumped in a canvas chair with her name lettered on it.
He's a real thinker, isn't he?
He's a talented child who expected us to cast a starlet he could dominate, not an actress that he'd have to compete with.
Oh, for the life of a movie star, the glamour, the excitement, the aching behind.
You're doing great. Oh, one thing, Isabel, before you go.
Yes?
I just heard about a deal on 4 new tires. I can't use them. Wondered if you or maybe Andrade...
Not me. I'm in good shape, and Andrade just bought some.
Oh, really? When?
Well, 2 weeks, I think.
I don't suppose you'd remember what they were.
Sure. The same as he turned in the Firestones. Hasta luego, Patron.
It had begun to rain. Ellis was coming toward me across the lot. He was drunk, weaving drunk, as though he'd been wandering, not sure of where he was. He kept widening his eyes in an effort to focus. We stopped under an overhang.
Hey, how are you? Mary said you wanted to see me.
Red's in trouble, Leonard. She's going to be arrested.
I need a drink.
You're going to choke eventually on that poison.
Oh, what's the difference? Who'd even notice I was gone?
Heidi. Come on, Leonard. Let's go back to the office.
Heidi doesn't give a ticker damn about anybody but herself. Her mother's daughter. A bad seed. I know. Question is, where did her mother get it? Not from my side of the family. Never was a murder on the other side to her.
Doesn't matter what your priest thinks, my friend. Suicide is not murder.
Who told you about my daughter?
Matter of fact, Red did.
She tell you she killed herself?
She said that Florence and her husband were a double suicide.
Yeah? Florence shot her husband in the head after dinner one night and then stuck the gun in her own mouth and pulled the trigger. I bet they were June 3rd. She would have been 38 years old yesterday. Now you know why the old sot started drinking last night and kept it up and up and up. I'm all right. All right. Don't worry.
The rain had increased. It fell straight down in steely sheets, roaring onto the pavement. I raced up the slippery steps, on into the building and into my office. Ellis right behind me.
Oh, wait, he's just coming in.
Mary seemed suddenly flustered. She was on the phone, jiggling it to get her party back. Jack was there, waiting to drive me home.
Hi, Mr. Blixton. Hey, can you believe this rain?
Jack. Mary, was that Red on the phone?
No, it was Heidi for her grandfather, but she's hung up. Leonard, she wants to know if you're coming home.
Mary, give me your file key. Come on.
The bottle's empty. I threw it out.
Mary, I want the key.
The bar's closed, Leonard. I went into my office and dialed Red immediately. No answer. I put the phone back in its cradle, vaguely conscious of the conversation from my outer office. Mary was on the phone talking to Heidi, something about whether or not Ellis would be coming home for dinner.
Heidi, your grandfather says you go ahead, fix yourself a TV dinner, and then he'll eat when he gets there.
I saw him lunge for the phone, but the connection had already been broken.
Why did you let me talk to her?
Leonard, you're too drunk. Now sober up before you go out. Here, have some black coffee.
Mary was right. He was drunk. I offered to take him in the cab, but he just walked on ahead of us when Jack and I came out of the office. I told Jack to take me to Red's apartment. The only thing I could hope for was that I'd find her there. I wasn't in the mood for conversation.
Hey, I made one up for her. A haiku for Miss Redfern. You want to hear it? Listen to this. Snowman on the hill, melting in the springtime sun. That's me when you smile.
That's nice, Jack.
Nice? You kidding? That's lousy.
No. Not at all. Not lousy at all. I know exactly what you mean. Exactly. And I did. Exactly. Snowman on the hill, melting in the springtime sun. That's me when you smile. There was no smile when we got to Red's place. There were police cars, flares, and barricades.
More units? Any units in the area to 16,000 to Long Bridge?
A cop in the street was waving for us to drive on. I told Jack to go back to the corner and wait for me. Then I changed my mind when I realized that all of the excitement was at Ellis' apartment. There was no way to make out a voucher in the downpour, so I dug out a $5 bill, paid Jack, and sent him away. Sergeant Ames? Oh, Blixen, where's Miss Redfern?
In custody. She's been booked for this murder, too.
This murder? In 2 minutes, I had the story. Detectives Ames and Griswold had been second and third to see the body. Red was first. They found her standing over it. Heidi Ellis was dead. Murdered. And Heidi's blood was all over Red's hands.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Someone's Death. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Just when we are safest, there's a sunset touch, a fancy from a flower bell, Someone's Death, a chorus ending from Euripides. Robert Browning on Men and Women. For television producer Nils Frederik Blixen, Someone's Death was prologue to a show unwritten. He cast himself in the hero's role. His youthful casting director, Joanna Redfern, his leading lady. But somebody is not following the script. A second Someone's Death has been written in. Nor is Joanna Redfern playing her part as she should. The heroine is not supposed to be found at the scene of the crime with blood on her hands. For Nils Frederik Blixen, life behind the camera was never this frustrating. But that's the difference between fiction and fact. And the fact remains. Someone's death was murder. Our story continues after this word.
One would have thought, seeing Heidi, that she'd fallen asleep over her book. She'd been struck twice in the face by a sharp instrument with a long blade, probably an axe. The murderer may have been splashed, probably had been. An examination would show traces of blood in the trap under the kitchen sink where he or she had washed. No one in the fourplex had heard a sound. The murder weapon was nowhere to be seen. I stood in the doorway and watched a police car drive Red away, her face in the window blurred by rain. Sergeant Ames, I want Miss Redfern's attorney notified.
He has been. Did you know the child that was killed?
Child. Tragic, tragic child. My God. Her grandfather get home?
No, he didn't.
When did this happen?
We found her about 10 minutes to seven. She hadn't been dead long.
I know.
Oh?
My secretary spoke to her.
Why don't you come back inside, Mr. Blitzen?
In Red's apartment, Detective Ames took a statement from a pale, perspiring Rene Ortiz, who protested he knew nothing. He'd come home with a severe headache, he'd taken 3 aspirins, and he'd been awakened by the police at 7.
I believe you have a roommate, Mr. Ortiz, Mr. Leeds.
Bobby Leeds,
Where is Mr. Leeds now?
I am sorry, I cannot tell you. He is no longer living at my place. We had a little disagreement.
Where does he work?
No. Bobby does not work. He is a lily of the field. Occasionally, he acts. You might say he is a mimic, a female impressionist.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ortiz. You may go. Oh, and send up the boy, Phil Waters, will you?
Oui.
Incidentally, Mr. Blixen, you said the little girl called your office tonight. At what time was that?
About 6:30, I should guess. I had looked at my watch at 6:25, and my secretary said Heidi had called a little before that, and then she phoned back about 6:30.
And you spoke to the child at that time?
My secretary spoke to her.
Your secretary's name and address, Mr. Blixen?
Miss Mary McGrath, 400½ Willow Way, and that's in Glendale.
Uh-huh. Would Miss McGrath be familiar with the little girl's voice?
Absolutely. They'd spoken to each other many times.
On the telephone,
On and off the telephone.
There's no way she could be fooled, not even by a professional mimic like a female impersonator?
Well, my secretary certainly didn't say anything. It was Heidi's voice as far as she was concerned. And that's all I can go on. May I ask one question?
Certainly.
Do you have the murder weapon?
Nope.
Then why have you arrested Miss Redfern?
Well, Miss Redfern stated she arrived home at approximately 6:45. She said she noticed the Ellis door open slightly, called to Heidi, got no answer, and walked in. Now, we came along a few minutes later, heard someone cry out. Miss Redfern was standing over the body with blood on her hands.
Schreiber picked me up the next morning to go see Red where they were holding her at the Sybil Brand facility for women.
Oh, in my opinion, Nils, they would have been better to concentrate on tying her to the Gladstone murder. Now they have to show a connection between Gladstone and Heidi, and I don't think they're going to be able to do that.
Is that your good news for the day?
Well, it's a try.
What are you dragging your heels about? Get her off the Gladstone murder. She bought a gun. Well, let him do a ballistics test on it.
Nils Frederick, I'm afraid there's a bit of a hitch there.
What do you mean?
You see, the other day when your boss Todd had Red fired, she went home, got in her newly repaired car, drove down to the pier, and took the boat trip to Catalina.
And threw the gun overboard.
Yes, that's right. It's at the bottom of the ocean. Nobody will ever find it.
When I saw Red come into the visiting room, she seemed to have grown smaller. Behind her, the police matron who brought her in stood and gazed like a cat at a remote distance. There was a glass wall between us, and Red's voice came to me through a phone.
Like my outfit?
How are they treating you? Do you need anything?
Could you send me the trades?
Oh, sure. They'll be lucky if Schreiber doesn't sue for false arrest before it's over.
Don't tell me you two hamburgers still think I'm innocent.
As the day is long.
There's never a Kleenex around when you want one. How's Leonard Ellis?
Leonard, I don't know.
The police tell me he's been hospitalized. They found him in some bar, told him about Heidi, and he began to get severe chest pains.
My poor guy. All right, I'll check into it. Red, did you notice anything out of the ordinary before you went into Ellis' apartment last night?
Just the door was open.
Was that usual?
Well, it was never open. They were all burglar freaks. They hear them every night. There are enough locks and chains and bolts to outfit a dungeon on every door.
Our time was up. The matron was approaching. I told Red I'd be back. She put her hand on the glass, palm flat, and I rested my palm on the other side against hers as though we were touching. I left the building. By the time I got back to the studio, I didn't think anything was worth too much. There was a strange secretary in my office. Took me a moment or two to remember that last night at the office, just before Jack and I had stepped out into the rain, Mary had told me she was flying out in the morning to Chicago to see her sick father. I smiled at the new secretary. She had the heat turned up and her coat over her shoulders, but none of it seemed to warm her in the least. I picked up all my messages from her desk, including one from Tibbetan Research. It read, "The threatening letter, the words were cut out of Star Eyes Comics, April 15th, 1972 issue. Good man, Tibbet." I spent the next 10 minutes on the phone. Good Samaritan Hospital to check on Leonard Ellis. Learned nothing, except that he was in intensive care. Hung up and got a call from Ames.
Blixen?
Yes.
I wanted to talk to your secretary, Mary McGrath, but I got somebody else. Thought I had the wrong office. Where is Miss McGrath?
In Chicago. Her father's sick, didn't I tell you?
No, you gave me her address in Glendale, but there's no one there.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was pretty shook up last night. I've got the number right here. Just a minute. Yeah, 427-3099. I don't remember the area code.
I'll get it, thanks.
I spent the day at my desk going over all of the scripts that were ready to shoot. It was 5 o'clock when I got another call from Sergeant Ames.
We called the number you gave us in Chicago for your secretary, Miss McGrath. She wasn't there.
Well, her father's very ill. She might have been at the hospital.
Nope. Called a couple of her friends as well. No sign of her. So we went to the airline at L.A. here. She never got on the plane. Hey, Mr. Blixen?
I'm here. I'm trying to find an explanation. She was very close to her father. She told me he was dying.
Well, he passed away at noon, Chicago time. Well, I'd better notify missing persons.
I hung up and sat thinking about Mary and the two deaths that had already occurred. Mary? How could she be involved? Was I losing my sanity? Was there a straight line through Dan Gladstone, Heidi, Mary? Where would it end? And with whom? Jack was parked in his usual place waiting for me, reading the late edition of the Times and looking at the legs of starlets as they passed the checkout point at the gate.
Hi, Mr. Blixen. Hey, what do you hear from our girl?
I saw her this morning. She'll make it. Let the traffic clear a little bit, Jack. I just want to sit here for a minute.
You know, my wife, Dolores, she's got it all paid. She says they're railroading Miss Redfern, and she says the kid's grandfather did it.
What's she based that on?
Well, for one thing, the paper said there were 3 or 4 locks on the front door, and all of them were open. And Dolores figures the kid was waiting for whoever lived there to come in. The paper said she was on the couch, so she didn't open the door herself. The locks were off, and the guy came right in.
Unless he picked the locks first.
Why, you can't pick a lock without making some kind of noise.
Oh, but it was raining. That might have covered it.
Hey, what's the matter? Don't you want the old man to be guilty?
Something like that. Besides, he left the studio at the same time we did last night, 6:30 or thereabouts. He couldn't have gotten to the apartment, killed the girl, and split before Red arrived.
But when did she...
About 6:45.
Well, it'd be tight, but I think he could make it.
In 15 minutes?
I don't know. I have to run it myself.
Do it. Do it now. I want to go over there anyhow.
All right. You time it, but wait till I get out of the lot. Hey, I feel like Mario Andrade. Now, who's going to pay the fine if the cops stop me?
They'd better not stop you.
I hope you're right.
We crossed Santa Monica, turned right onto a congested alley, left a narrow street, and east again toward Vine. There were no automatic signals on Jack's route. At the boulevard stops, he paused and nosed at once into honking traffic. 12 minutes and 20 seconds later, we pulled to a stop in front of the fourplex.
Okay, how about that?
You're a professional driver, and you barely made it. Ellis was drunk. The streets were wet. No, I can't buy it. It's out of reason, all out of reason. Leonard Ellis was the only one in the whole house who couldn't have done it.
Except, of course, Miss Redfern, maybe?
Yeah, that's true. You better not wait, Jack. I want to pick up something from the garage, and I've no idea how long I'll be. I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah, right.
On the walk, Boom Boom, wearing shapeless coveralls and a pith helmet, was using a small hand hoe to replant one of the rain-shattered rose bushes.
Ah, Neil Frederick. You see, Sherry, it is foolish to try to raise anything beautiful in this violent city. I loathe that little girl, that Ivy, but she was part of the house, part of the fun. And now she's gone. Joanna's in jail. Poor Leonard is in the hospital. Bobby's left. Nothing is the same.
Bobby's left? Do you know where he's gone?
He called. He want to know about the funeral. He's living with another boy in La Cañada.
I want to ask you a favor. I understand Heidi kept a number of magazines, comic books, in the garage.
Oh, too many. I was going to call the trash man.
Well, before you do, I'd like to go through them, if I may.
Bon chance then, chérie.
As I walked along the root buckle driveway, I could hear Phil practicing. He was home. I paused under the ground floor window to listen.
It's not bad, huh?
It was Boom Boom's husband, Fred, pushing through the screened back door, coming down the warp steps with a glass of wine in each hand. He looked curiously clownish in wide, baggy pants, a gray undershirt, and loose carpet slippers. And that's how I pegged him, a quiet clown.
Compliments of the house, Mr. Blixen.
Thank you, Mr. Hayward. I didn't want either of you to go to any trouble.
It's Fred, and you're a guest. And guests are no trouble to Boom Boom. They're the breath of life. Drink it. She makes it.
That's very good.
Boom Boom says you want to look through the comic books in the garage, huh? Come on, I'll help you.
The garage was ramshackle and unfinished, built for the thinner, taller cars of the 20s. It wasn't true that the comic books were piled to the roof, but there must have literally been thousands. Stacked along both side walls and the rear, some loose, some tied in uneven bundles, some torn and old, some recent.
Which one you looking for?
Star Eyes, April 15th, 1972.
Star Eyes.
We tackled it from opposite sides, restacking as we went. Halfway through the first pile, I thought I heard footsteps outside. It sounded like someone paused outside the garage near the heavy raised door, perhaps to watch and listen. Fred, engrossed in the search, hadn't noticed. I swallowed the last of the wine and I drifted toward the entrance. I looked casually down the drive and into the rear yard and along the porch. There was no one there. And the guitar practicing had ceased.
I'm up to March. April 1st, 8th, April 15th. Here it is.
Good. Let me see it. Fred, you see these holes in the pages? Now, I say that Heidi cut the words out of this magazine for the threatening letter she sent to Red.
But the writer threatened to kill Dan Gladstone. I know Heidi was a weirdo, but she wouldn't have killed nobody.
She could drive. She could have been out of the house that night.
Mr. Blixen, if you tell the police all this, you know what they're going to think?
No, what?
Well, if Red figured out that Heidi killed her great love, and if she came out here and found the magazine and put two and two together like you just did, couldn't the police say that was enough motive for her to kill Heidi?
Fred Hayworth wasn't a clown. I was. There was no answer I could give him. I just walked away. At 4:30 in the morning, I gave up the idea of sleep and I stepped onto my balcony to wait for sunrise. At 8:30, I was in Walter Tibbetts' office in research, seated at the chrome desk under the cobwebs, comparing my mutilated copy of Star Eyes with the whole one that he had.
So, what do you expect to accomplish with this thing now that I, run it down for you?
I'm not sure. I was playing detective. I hoped that I'd be able to help my casting director.
You mean that nice kid they arrested? Joanna Redfern?
Yes.
Help her. How?
Oh, that's too complicated. Just believe me when I say it didn't work.
Wait a minute there. What was that?
What was what?
Let me see your copy.
Walter, what are you doing?
Pages 17 and 18 are missing from your copy.
And they weren't part of the original cutout?
No, because I showed you those parts. Peter, Laurie, and the bug-eyed monsters. What does that mean? And on page 18 as well, continuation of same story.
Oh, sure. They're a rock music group.
And stills of the real Peter Laurie on the back. You remember M?
Oh, yeah, beautiful. That was a gorgeous performance. Scared the hell out of me. It's been so long. Wasn't M a kidnapper?
No, a child molester. Most despicable criminal in Berlin. Remember, the police couldn't find him? Well, finally, the underworld took over. They captured him. Executed him, I think.
Yeah, they talk about the movie here, in your copy.
Well, what's the connection? This wasn't part of the threatening letter that you showed me.
No. Unless there was another letter. Wait a minute. There's some other places cut out.
Let me see it. I'll compare them. Write this down. Go to the $300 cash each and every month for life, I will pay or, that's O-A-R.
O-A-R.
O-A-R, police. That's it.
Well, that's plain enough. Pay $300 cash each and every month for life, or I will go to the police.
You want to know something? A person could get killed sending letters like that.
A person did. I walked back to my office in a daze. My substitute secretary hadn't come in yet, but my phone was ringing. Blixen here.
Ames. I called your apartment. You left early.
What is it, Sergeant?
We found your secretary, Mary McGrath.
The bullet, fired at close range, had entered her left eye near the nose, shattered the back of the skull, and spent itself inches short of the kitchen drain board. The brackish odor of death permeated the small house from end to end. According to the deputy coroner, she had been dead for approximately 40 hours.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Someone's Death. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by V8, Chews Wrigley Chewing Gum and Beats Nut Chewing Tobacco. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.